Well, I want to close our series with that thought of worship. I have a lot of application tonight. I wanted to plan not a full sermon because I kind of figured it might get late. But I don't think I would be a good steward of the privilege. And I don't think I would serve you well if I did not give this to the Lord and go truly to his word and share with you things that wonderful gold that's there. So let me begin by saying that there is a great crisis in the world. In fact, the greatest crisis in the world is worship. People all over the world exist, and they do not exist to make much of God. They do not love the Lord their God with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength. And if you don't get it, this weekend has been an effort, at least in what the Lord has given me to do, this week has been an effort to nail that. It's not about your mind as much as it is about God. Your mind just happens to be the most important part of you to worship him. There's a great crisis in the world, and that crisis is worship. God is not honored as God. And the worship of crisis, the crisis that is worship, is a crisis of the human mind. And so James 4, verse 8 says, draw near to God, that's worship, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Therein he attaches worship and its crisis to the mind and its crisis. Draw near to God, the only way is if you purify your heart double-minded. Double-minded, meaning I say one thing when I sing songs to Jesus and in my mind I'm thinking something else, either during or after and through the week. Hypocrisy is what we call it. In Acts chapter 15, verse 9, there's a statement that is made that is so powerful because it explains, how then do you purify your heart? I love this. That the Lord made no distinction between us and them. Those barriers that break us as human beings, separate us by superficial and evil, man-centered distinctions like skin color or culture. And he says, no, the Jew and the Gentile, he made no distinction between us in Christ. And so I love this, having cleansed their hearts by faith. Amen. 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 The issue is, how do you cleanse your heart, double-minded people like us? How do we do that? By faith. God cleanses our heart by faith. So I want to launch this idea of the mind and close our time on the mind for the sake of worship to God with Philippians as a theme for our movement tonight as submission. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, and it says, have this mind among yourselves, or within you, all of you collectively, within you, have this mind. And he puts mind up there. He says, have this mind in you. Oh, what mind? Which is yours in Christ. The only way you can have this mind. And what is it? I love this. It is Christ's mind. Have Christ's mind in you. Verse 6, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped or an entitlement to be demanded and held on to and say, I demand that those creatures show me worship. I demand that when I come to them that they would see me as God. Christ didn't have that kind of a mind. He deserved it, but he didn't have that kind of a mind. Instead, he said, had this mind in you, like Christ, who though he is God, said, I'm not going to demand what I deserve. But he emptied himself by taking the form
of a servant,
a slave, literally.
He's master, and he took the form of a slave. I also love this because it says he emptied himself by adding. That's interesting. And this is the only time where you will find that, you know, subtraction occurs by addition. He emptied himself by adding, by being born in the likeness of men. Verse 8, and being found in human schema is the Greek word. Schema, you software buffs might understand, in database of schema. It's the appearance, it's the outward presentation. So he, being found, he was discovered by human eyes in a schema, an appearance of a human being. But this is the key. He, Jesus, humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Remember this, beloved friends. I want you to take that passage and think about what is being said. Have this mind in you. Start here. Your salvation is here being cast as a frame of mind. Your salvation is being described to you in terms of a mind. So it's in the mind of God that he acted on his mind, and that he acted on his mind in such a way that you have supreme and highest benefit. And how does he do this? Not by the way that men usually use their minds, making much of themselves, pride. But he humbled himself. That's the mind of God, is a mind of such love, such sacrifice. Your salvation is cast in terms of a mind, and you're told to take it on and have that mind in you. You're saved by that mind. So now put on that mind. Have that mind in you and live that mind. Live the mind in the likeness of your salvation. That's good. There can be no mind of Christ where there is no humility and no submission. You do not have the mind of Christ if you have no humility and no submission, because that's the mind that he described. Christ then should mark our minds. If we claim his name, he should mark our minds, our hearts. And that is, his humility should mark us. His submission should mark us. His obedience should mark us. His love should mark us. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 1. Since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves. Listen to this. Arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. So have this mind in you. A mind that is so captive to the glory of God that in a Gethsemane picture, you will never experience a Gethsemane experience. But if you dare to think that you might come in some figment of a minuscule portrayal of that incredible epic experience, have this mind in you that says, Father, if it be your will, take this cup from me. But not my will, your will be done. Have this mind in you. He says, Peter says, since therefore Christ suffered, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. So when your life is tanking and you're drowning, and like our brother Keith just wonderfully edified me with this testimony, the glory of God and the power of his grace to bring a child home. But when you're in that midst of just total tanking and you're going to sink in the, or how our brother Peter gave us that word, wonderful word about taking our eyes off of Christ and looking to the storm. That's exactly right. If If you are not arming yourself with the mind of Christ to submit and to suffer for the glory of Christ, for the glory of God, if you don't have that mind disciplined, when the storm comes, you will not stand, or you will look for escape. And I just want to lovingly encourage you to see, when trials come in your life, the scripture never says, look for a way of escape. It says, escape temptation, not escape the trial. It never says when the storm comes, oh, go hide and find a hiding place. No, you know what it calls you to? Have a different mind. Have a different mind. And in case you doubt that that mind could exist, I want you to see someone, the scripture says, and the Spirit points to the Son. Have that mind in you. So that you can have such a mind that you would live for the glory of God, even if it meant death. Have this mind in you. Arm yourself and don't think in terms of, okay, my life is miserable and my only hope is if I can escape the conditions. Wrong. It's not your only hope. Sometimes those conditions will not leave. Sometimes those conditions will only get worse. The scripture says, have this mind in you. Discipline your mind to think a different way so that it's not the conditions that need to be removed. It's the thinking that needs to be changed. And not for ourselves first. You know, it takes genuine love. It takes genuine trust in your Father to be able to say in the midst of such pain, I will stay. I will stand firm. I will press on. I will not drift. It takes trust in Him when you hurt. That's what we need to have. That's the point. It's easy to love God when things are going well and you feel blessed and you are happy and you're around people who are happy and things are just going great and you're singing a song of praise and you see something beautiful, and it's easy to love God. You don't need the disciplined mind for that. You need it for the real world. When Kemskalaw's over, when you go back to the bills and the pain and the temptations and all the other things and all the neighbors and the parents and whoever else might be in your life, a spouse even possibly, those conditions that cause great difficulty. That's when you need the discipline mind. I feel like I should just stop and go home and pray or something. I love you guys. I want you to get this. I say that because I really want you to see the importance of it. You know, most human thinking is chiefly marked by pride. And what we see here is a mind that is marked by submission. Pride. You know, there was even pride in seminary. It's a sad thing. That's a sad thing. What a contradiction. There's pride among many pastors. That's a despicable thing. There are far too many tadpoles in Christianity. You know what a tadpole is? All head, no body. Big heads. Big heads. Yeah! It's all about me, myself, and I. Yet I'm here to worship. No, you're not. Proverbs 16:5 says, everyone who is arrogant in heart is an abomination to the Lord. Be assured he will not go unpunished. Proverbs 21:24, a scoffer. When you hear the word scoffer, the Bible actually defines the word. It says, scoffer is the name of the arrogant, haughty man who acts with arrogant pride. That's a scoffer. When Jesus was born, or the testimony of his life, it was a wonderful response. Luke 1:51. He has shown strength with his arm, and he has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. The very advent of Jesus Christ, the testimony and the response was, God has scattered the proud because God took on human flesh and was born in a filthy manger. Humility from the beginning and to the end. Obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Pride is really the wrong. It's really thinking wrongly about yourself. So I want to take us to Romans chapter 12, verse 1. I appeal to you, therefore, brethren, after 11 chapters of powerful theology, right? Wonderful theology. Oh, I could swim forever in the ocean of Romans. He says, you get to chapter 12, he says, look, I appeal to you, therefore. Whenever you see therefore in Scripture, always answer the question, what's the therefore, therefore? What's the therefore, therefore? Right? It's a therefore. So the therefore is therefore because you got 11 chapters of power that needs a therefore. Therefore, on the basis of that reality, maybe we should think this way. And the way we should think is this. By the mercies of God, present your bodies. How do you do that? How do you, the you, present you as a body? I'll tell you. The mind, the heart, the soul, the inner you. The you that's immaterial says, all right, body, this is what you're going to do. I'm going to sacrifice you. That's what he's saying. You hear this theology, 11 chapters of it, therefore do something with your mind that will sacrifice your body, even if it means pain. And it says, therefore, present your body, who? The mind, the heart. Present your body as a living sacrifice. I love that because, you know, sacrifices usually are dead. They get killed when they get sacrificed. This one is a living one. It continues to be constantly sacrificed. Holy and acceptable, dedicated, pulled away from the world, pulled away from self, pulled away from all this defilement and given wholly to God. The mind says, this is what we're doing with our life. And then it says, that's acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. That's when you do this, your mind, your whole being worships God. It's the picture that the mind is worshiping God as the priest of the body. And the body is worshiping God as the sacrifice to God. So your mind is the priest sacrificing the body as the offering, and it's all worship. It's wonderful. I can't see your faces, but you should, you know, something. I don't know, maybe not smile, but just be amazed. Praise God for that. And then he doesn't end there, right? He says, this is going to be worship. Hon, I love it. And then he says, let's turn the coin. Look on the backside of the tabernacle. Let's see what it looks like. It looks like this. The negative, the positive is you are worshiping by being a priest in your mind and sacrificing your body to God. And the negative is then, verse 2, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And then what does he say? That by testing, that by fire, trial, not removing the fire, not removing the storm, but by these conditions even that are painful, you may, through the mind, discern what is the will of God. Like, not my will, but thine be done. Have this mind in you. And then he says, what is good and acceptable and perfect? Just to remind us, it is good. What Christ did in Gethsemane was good. Acceptable to God and perfect. But to us, we might scoff and say, well, isn't it not good to go against what you want? Well, every time you get up early in the morning and you turn snooze, but you end up getting up because you have something important to do, you go against what you want. That's not wrong. Let me give you an example. You do want to violate wrong impulse always, and don't think you're playing hypocrite at that point. Like, well, I'm forcing myself. I'm forcing obedience, and that's not right. I'm a hypocrite. No, 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 no. Watch this. If a man is struggling with lust, so that he might be tempted into an affair. And yet, there's two things. He loves his wife. He loves his children. He loves God. And yet there's this temptation that is so powerful. He's got two wants. Two. One, a love here that's right, and another, a love here that's wrong. So for him to deny this desire, does that make him a hypocrite? You know what it does? No. It only proves that he has two desires warring inside, and he actually prioritized one over the other. It doesn't make him a hypocrite. It actually proves he's doing the right thing. He prioritized the right desire over the wrong desire. Just like when you're super tired and you got to get up to go to church, and you get up and you don't want to get up, everything in your body says, no, just stay there. And you say, no, you have two desires. One desire, I want to sleep. The other desire, I want to honor God. When you deny the desire to sleep in that experience, you're not being a hypocrite. You're not violating your conscience. You're actually obeying another desire. The real issue then is, which desire is right? Which desire is more excellent? Which desire will bring greater glory to God and ultimately greater joy to your soul? That's what you do. That wasn't in my notes. But it's very important right here that you might know what is good and acceptable and perfect. In verse 3, this is where I was going with pride. Watch this. Romans chapter 12, verse 3. For by grace, the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you. Look at this. We've got one verse. Chapter 12, verse 3. One verse. And in one verse, Paul writes four times something about the mind. Four times. I want to underscore them. From the Greek language, you can't see it in the ESV so excellently, the last one, but watch this. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think, phroneo, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to, phroneo, think, but to, phroneo, think. Number three, with, and here's the word, sober judgment. This is actually sober thinking. So I'm telling you how you ought to think. You ought not to think a certain way. You ought to think this way, and that is a sober thinking. Wow. You think you might be a little concerned about your mind after 11 chapters of theology? Therefore, based on that, you might want to think a certain way. You might want to change your thinking. I love this. Each according to the measure of faith God has assigned. It's all grace. It's all grace. You don't make yourselves mental giants. If you struggle with math, it might be some of your discipline, but predominantly, it's just the way you're wired. If you get it, if it comes easy to you, praise God. Give God glory. He gave you that mind. And the same is true in faith. Just don't be irresponsible. Be a good steward of this mind. 1 Peter 3:8 tells us, finally, all of you, I thought that was fitting, finally, because it's the end of last message of this series. Finally, all of you, have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Oh, that's what we need. Humble mind for submission. I have another text that I'm going to base, and then one other that's my main message, then I'll get to just application and draw us to a close. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 7. 2 Timothy 2, 7 is a major verse I want us to have in this series. I think it's critical for us to get. Here, Paul writes, think over what I say, meaning what he wrote. Think over the Bible. Now watch this. For, that for is causative, meaning think over what I say, because the Lord will give you understanding in everything. What? I love that. You know why? Because we wouldn't write it like that. We would write it like, think over what I say in order to understand it. That's how we would write it. Think about what you're reading in order to understand it. He doesn't say that. No, he doesn't say that. He says, no, you think as hard as you can. You apply your mind as the highest scholar in the discipline and you possibly can muster over that sacred desk, reading that word. You labor to understand it. And if you do, the Lord did that. Ooh, that's a little bit humbling. Labor as hard as you can. Think over what I wrote, Timothy, because you need to think, because you need to think, because God gives understanding. We don't think like that. We would rewrite it maybe the other way. We might say, oh, don't worry about thinking about it, because the Lord will give you understanding. You can be charismatic. You know, I don't mean that. I don't want to say too negative, but I mean, you can have this mentality where you say, I don't need to study. It just all comes to me. The Lord just gives me understanding. Wrong. Think because the Lord gives you understanding. Does that strike anyone here? Right. Okay, that's pretty serious. That's pretty serious. Because what he just said is it's both. Don't play games. Don't play games like, no, I don't need to think. I don't need to prepare to speak before people about the Lord. It just comes to me. No. Read the Word of God. Make sure you know what you're saying is what that word meant to say. And if you say anything that's right, it's because the Lord gave you understanding. Amen. That's why. I think that's important. Because both human thinking and divine illumination are in view. It speaks of human responsibility right next to divine sovereign grace. Oh, that's good. I don't know about you, but that's like makes my heart skip a beat. I love that because I love that. I just love that God is the one that I look to for these things. But I also want to point this out. Here what we see is the head exists for the heart. What we see is that logic exists for love. What we see is that contemplation exists for affection. No, do you see that? You guys, it's too dark out there because I can't see your faces. I want you to be like, yeah! Yeah!
Yeah!
Yeah!
Yeah!
Okay, that's good. This is the issue. You've got to think about these things. If you don't think about them, don't expect to be excited. Don't expect to get it. Don't expect to say amen to this. This is great. Don't expect to enjoy a sermon. If you're not thinking about it, listen, the mind exists, the head exists for the heart, logic exists for love. You're supposed to use the logic of 11 chapters to make the logical connection to love. That's the point. So contemplation over the Word of God is for the affections of your heart, mind, for you to love Him with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. You will not love a God you do not know. And you will only know Him through true, deep, consecrated contemplation. You've got to have it. And self-discipline is the tool. I am convinced by the Scriptures. This is not something I came up with. This is just all over the place. I'm convinced that self-discipline is the tool that God has given, suited to promote godly stewardship of this redeemed mind. Discipline is indispensable. There is no substitute for it. He is a contradiction who is an undisciplined disciple. That word disciple means disciplined. So, who's a disciple of Jesus Christ? You need to be disciplined after Jesus Christ. And you do that not in flesh and blood first. Proverbs 5:23, he dies, this person dies for lack of discipline, and because of his great folly, he is led astray. You will be led astray in life if the mind is not disciplined on the Lord. You'll be led astray. He dies for lack of discipline. Kid, just absolutely central. All of the disciplines start and hinge and are sustained here. My last text for this series that I'm on a major on is this one, for a little outline of 3 points: a goal, a means, and a value. A goal, a means, and a value for this disciplined mind. And it's going to be 1 Timothy 4, 7, and 8. At the end of 7, it says, rather, train yourself. I love this. Oh, man. Train yourself. This is tough. Train yourself. Discipline yourself for godliness. Verse 8. For while bodily training is of some value, godliness is of value in every way, as it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. My first point is that the goal is clearly godliness. The discipline of the mind, the goal is godliness. Your submission to these principles is for godliness, for the love of God, for the glory of God. First importance is the goal of Christian training or discipline, and it is godliness. Plain and simple. We must emphasize then the importance of keeping the goal of discipline in mind at all times. You know why? Because discipline without a clear goal becomes drudgery. That's why. I mean, if you have to practice, you know, if you're trying to learn something, you have to discipline yourself and sacrifice and take time to, like, learn how to play the guitar. And you're looking out the window and you see your buddies playing basketball and you're like, man. If it's just drudgery. Like, how long does it take to get this? That's a Christian life. And so the question is, what are you looking at as you're going through the discipline? Looking out the window at some other game? Or is it where you're looking at the goal? You're looking at the goal and you're saying, no, that's where I'm going. It's as if, imagine if someone could come in and show a video to a young man who's struggling with playing guitar. And he comes in and shows him this video, and like he's Christopher Parkening or something, right? And so this young guy is like, oh man, I don't want to do this. And the guy comes in and says, you know, I'm from the future and I'm going to show you a video of what you are like in 20 years and world-class classical guitarist. Huh. Well, then I'll practice. Let's go. You know, I mean, then you'll get it. What you should do is keep in mind who you are in Christ, what the goal is in Christ. Keep the goal in mind and it'll drive you. Stay focused on him and it'll drive you. I love, there's a story I heard about a man, I don't recall his name, but this was years ago. Again, world class. At the time, he was number one violinist. Just amazing, amazing man. He was like in his 70s or 80s. And he did this amazing concert. Just blew people away. And a young, zealous, young violinist is just so excited. Afterwards, he goes around the side, goes up the stairs to the stage. He, like, meets this guy as he's coming down. He's just so excited. He's like, oh, you know, I wanted to kiss his feet or whatever. And he's like, you know, I just, I would give my life to play like you. He looked down at the young man and didn't even skip a beat. And he just said, young man, I have. What's the point? Well, the point is, you don't get there without a lifetime of discipline. Some Christians, you know, they're like that. I mean, if you could only see Christ, you'd run up and say, man, I want to be like that. I would give my life for that. And Christ is saying, it's the only way you can. It's the only way you can. There are no shortcuts. No shortcuts. Keep the goal in mind. Go for it. Keep the aim like any Olympic champion. I love this. The analogy is very simple. It's one that I didn't invent. It's one that Paul gave us. Because the Olympian, the champion, is always one who is disciplined to keep the goal in mind. To keep the goal in mind. This is 1 Corinthians 9:24. And it says, Paul writes, do you not know that in a race all the runners run? So we're all runners. But only one receives the prize. And then he says, I love this. So, therefore, here's logic for the sake of love. So, run that you may obtain it. Look at the goal and run for that goal. Verse 25, every athlete, Paul illustrates, every athlete exercises self-control
in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we, an imperishable. How much more should we be disciplined than the Olympic athletes out there that get something around their neck that's here today, gone tomorrow? When your discipline will echo forever, and the reward is never ending. Really? How much more ought we to be disciplined? Verse 26, so, Paul says, now he makes it personal, so I do not run aimlessly. I love that. He has the goal in mind. I don't run aimlessly. Can you imagine watching the Olympics and watching the guys running aimlessly? I mean, he like runs this way and they're the ones running that way and they're running super fast, but they're going everywhere. What in the world? Who's winning? They don't have the goal in mind. They might be the fastest guy on the track. You might have the abilities, you might have gifts that surpass us all here. Gifts of God, gifts in terms of God giving you gifts to worship Him and to impact this world for the glory of God. You might have gifts, but you're running like all over the field. You got to keep the goal in mind. Give that energy for that goal. I love this too. He says, I do not box as one beating the air. And what he's not talking about air boxing. He's talking about in a boxing match, here's my opponent, I'm hitting the air. I mean, hello, what kind of a, you're not going to win, man. You got danger coming. So here's the issue. You're in a Christian life, you're in a battle, you're not fighting over here, and there's your enemy. You got to run with the goal in mind. Keep focus. That's the first thing. The second thing is the means. The goal is first, godliness. Second thing is the means. The means is to train yourself. That's the means. The goal is for godliness. But he tells us how. Train yourself. Everything in life worth achieving requires discipline. Everything. The key word of this verse is gymnazo, where we get gymnasium. It's the word that really is gymnastics, and it's the idea of this hard training. In the NAS, it's translated discipline. In the King James, it's translated exercise. However it's translated, however, the Greek always conveys the intense discipline by which athletes of the first century were distinguished. They're distinguished by this hard work. Athletic training in the Greco-Roman culture involved three necessities. I'm just going to mention them: exertion, habits, and focus. Exertion is simple. I mean, why would you busy yourself in this world constantly treating symptoms instead of exerting yourself for causes? So keep the goal in mind and exert yourself to the goal. And don't only deal with symptoms. Exert yourself to this end. Habits. I mean, what makes a person good at anything? Practice. What makes them good at basketball? Practice. They might have some predisposed advantage, but they'll get good through practice. Guitar or any other thing, music, through practice. If the body requires exercise to develop refinement, so clearly does the mind. If a man does not exercise his arm, he ought not to expect an increasing bicep. And if, therefore, that same man, who might not be using his mind too well, does not exercise his mind, he ought not to expect an increasing godliness. The issue is the habit, the exertion. The means is training that's hard. Hard. You know, it's nonsensical to try changing behavioral habits without changing the mind, the habits of the mind. All you're doing, if you try to change your behavior, like you try to change a sin that you're committing, and you don't do it by a change of habit in your mind, all you're doing is addressing and patching symptoms. You're not addressing the cause. That's the issue. I mean,
And when I talk about this, you know how the Lord says, you'll know a tree by its fruits, right? So imagine, you got something going on, and there's the characteristic of a bad tree going on here. You got bad fruit coming out. Well, the Bible doesn't say, all right, this is what you do. Gather all that bad fruit and chop it to pieces, and you'll change the nature of the tree. You won't. Chopping the apples that are bad will not change the tree. So, don't play with the symptoms. Go to the mind, go to the heart, address it there for the sake of the tree to change. That's the key. The last point, exertion, I said habits and focus, and I thought, man, this is pretty good. I remember with my boys, we watched this silly little video called Cars. And I remember at the beginning, it just struck me. I thought of this text. I thought, oh, yeah. It struck me. You know why? The screen starts out dark. You get this, you know, music. And what do you hear? You hear focus, focus, focus. There's McQueen, right? McQueen sitting there in the dark, in the trailer before he comes out. And he's like, focus, focus, focus. And he starts thinking about something else. And then he starts to put the race back in mind. Focus, focus, focus. He's got it. They're right. That's what a true champion does. They're focused. They train themselves to be focused. They stay on watch. They don't allow distractions to derail them in their race. They stay focused. Therefore, if you have anxiety, you know what anxiety in the Greek, the word anxiety in Greek? It means the mind is literally pulled in different directions at the same time. So if you're worried, the problem is you're not focused where you ought to be. Instead, you will experience metaphysical problems because your mind is being pulled here and there and here and over there and over there, and you don't have concentration on the matter, and it creates a condition that we call stress. Not healthy. And that's why the Lord says, even for the mind here, you need discipline to focus, focus, focus to run the race. Also, it speaks of impulses. When you think about this, we are such impulsive creatures. I mean, I don't know how much money is made through windows. You know, you walk down, windows have all the stuff, and, oh, I think I need to buy that. What? No, you're impulsive. I mean, let me give you an idea. The entire advertisement industry profits on your impulse. You're impulsive. So I'll show you an over-exaggerated, glossy image of the most lumptuous meal when you go buy it. It looks like, you know, 3 days old in a microwave. But that impulse, you got me. You got me. The impulse got me there. We're impulsive. So what we've got to do is, in the discipline of the mind, for training for godliness, we've got to focus. We've got to exert ourselves to focus. When these things come at us, when the thought comes at you, you've got to stop it. Interrupt yourself. You know, in therapy, when you go through physical therapy, let's say my leg had major problems and I've got a major, you know, whatever, I had an accident and I need to relearn how to walk. Well, through therapy, what they would do is they would make me go through, and if I'm walking the wrong way, like for instance, my leg has a little problem, and so I wear my shoes on one foot, I wear my shoes out faster on one edge. So physical therapy makes me interrupt my stepping. Now, when I normally walk, I don't think about, okay, that's right, swing the thigh, and then move the knee. Okay. Oh, that's right. Put down the heel. Yeah, I mean, come on. You'd never get anywhere. So you don't think about it. You know what happens? It's second nature. You just walk. You see the thing you want. You go, oh, yeah, I want it. And then you go for it. And you just walk. It's just natural. It's step after step after step. The point is, that's how you make decisions in life. That's how you do live. You don't think about how you think. You don't think about, like, I don't think about how I walk. You don't think about how you think. You don't think about, well, if I say this, and then, okay, then I should say this, and okay, then I should, oh, and what if they say this? Well, then I should say, you just don't do it, or you drive along, and, well, if I see this, you don't think about it. So something pops up and you react. Just like when I want to go there, I walk a certain way. So the therapy, what it does is a therapist walks alongside and says, no, every time I go to put my foot down the wrong way at an angle, no, interrupt, put your foot, oh, okay. And the next time, oh, no, oh man. And you just keep getting interrupted. Well, that's what you need in your mind. Put an interrupter in your mind. Put an interrupter so that when you go through that next situation, you're driving home tomorrow, whatever it is, that if the mind starts to go somewhere, interrupt it. No, don't go there. And do that instantly. Address the impulse. One last little illustration on this focus is I like to think of wild horses. Well, that's fine, but I like to think of wild horses as an illustration of your thoughts. I mean, I like to think of wild horses, but that was a lefter. All right, so no, the point is, think of your thoughts like horses. Like horses. And so here you are, you're driving home tomorrow. No one's ever told you, do you know how to think right? No one's ever taught you how to think right. No one's ever addressed you to say, you know, there's a right way to think and a wrong way to think, not just what to think on, but the way you think. There's a wrong way to walk. You're going to wear your shoes out a certain way. You got to think differently. And so you're going, wow, you know, I never thought of that. And so you're driving and all of a sudden you realize, wait a second, what's going on with that thought? That one's like, wow, going way over there. And all of a sudden, boom, I'm going over here. And the issue is, it's like horses. Your thoughts are like horses, and your mind is like the jockey. And the problem is, the horses are going all over the place. They're wild. Your thoughts can be wild most of the time. They're all over. And this is the issue. A wild horse will try to run you into a tree or a branch to get you off. The thought just wants its own life. Let's just run this way. And if you say no, it says, we're going this way. So what do you have to do? Guess what? You have to train the horse. You have to break the horse. You have to domesticate the horse. You have to bring the horse into submission. And then when the horse says, I want to go over here, you pull the reins and you say, nuh-uh, this way. We're going over here. Are you following me? Get the illustration. I just pray that it makes sense. When your mind starts to go somewhere, interrupt the thought and pull the reins. No, I'm not thinking about that. I'm not going there. Put a wild horse in your mind. Black stallion or something. All right, the last point is the value. The goal, godliness. The means, exertion, training, discipline. And finally, the value. The value is why we're here. The value is why we've invested hours and hours to think about this and to give ourselves to it. It is a value of present and eternal magnitude. It is a value that is not measured on you, but a value that is measured in the worth of God. And that in how much you can enjoy and you can be blessed and be useful to God in the present forever. The verse, again, 1 Timothy 4:8, godliness is of value in every way. Oh, I'm sorry, let me start over here. For while bodily training is of some value, godliness, the training of the mind for the sake of glory to God, is of value in every way as it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. Bodily discipline clearly does not benefit your eternal health. But the discipline of your mind benefits both the present life and the life to come. And so the value is inestimable, and the mind plays the key role. Discipline of the mind, then, is discipline of self centrally and organically. That's so good. That's important. Ungoverned thoughts betray a form of imprudence at the most critical center of our being. The value of discipline and principled practice have been
lost to impulse gratification and pragmatism in our day, we must not, as Christians, allow it to become our practice. We must be disciplined in our minds for the sake of God. Well, I think I'm out of time. If I'm able to go to the place and you have questions, I would be more than delighted to talk with you. I do promise I'm not going to go into each of these, but I do want to just say them. I want to say headlines. That's it. Well, I'm going to try. I know it's late. I do thank you. But, you know, I might die tomorrow, and I'll be with the Lord, and then I'll never have a chance to see you again. So, well, no, I will have a chance later. 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 Yeah. No, later. I just meant I would never be able to see your progress, and I want to see it. I want to see you get this. I want you to love the Lord with all your heart now. You got me. All right, so here's the key. I haven't focused on enough. That's why I just got to say it. You got to pray, earnestly pray to God. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Incline my heart to your testimonies, O Lord. That's what David does. Pray. It's all of grace. If you are going to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, take all that we've said this weekend, and it is totally futile if God doesn't move. So you've got to pray. Fall on your face and beg God to incline your heart. It's the only way. Number one. Number two. I'm skipping over a lot. See? Saving time. Here we are. Number two. Meditate on the Lord and the gospel. We spent time on that this morning. You know, one thought, one picture again. It's like your engine in the car is locked in gear. The mind is always going somewhere. It's never in neutral. So make sure you steer it right. It's always going somewhere. You can't ever stop thinking. Number three, hate evil thoughts. I haven't addressed this enough. I just want to make the stress here that too many of us hate consequences of sin. We don't hate the sin. We actually enjoy the sin and only hate the consequences. If that's the way you're living and you think that you're disciplining the mind, or you think you're loving God by hating the consequences, you're dead wrong. Hating the consequences is not what we're called to. It's we're called to hate the sin itself for the sake of loving God. That's what we need. Number four, read, study, listen, meditate upon the Word of God. Amen?
Amen?
Number five, read good books and listen to good sermons. Because I didn't say that earlier. I thought it would be appropriate to say that. I don't want people to go out and say, oh, well, we can't listen to, you know, read books or something. But just remember this, and I mean this with all sincerity. 1 Thessalonians 5:21, test everything and hold fast to what is good according to the Word. So, make the Word of God your primary and benchmark and arbiter of every other form of information that you give yourself to. Test everything. Make sure it's good according to God. Be discerning. Number six, examine self. Oh, I love Hebrews chapter 3, verse 12. Take care, brothers, lest there be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart leading you to fall away from the living God. So examine yourself and remember that patterns of thought are important, not just the content. Patterns of thought. It reminds me of 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31. I love this verse. You all should know this verse, right? Therefore, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Notice what he does not say. He does not say what to eat or how to eat. He tells you only what you do with your mind. That's what he says. He doesn't say eat with chopsticks or eat with a spoon or make sure you don't eat this and make sure you don't drink that. He says here, there are places, but he says here, make sure that when you eat whatever you eat and whatever you do, it's always an issue of how you use your mind. So if you're eating, it doesn't matter what you're eating mostly, but when you're eating, make sure that whatever you are doing when you're eating, you are glorifying God. I think that's why we have 10,000 taste buds. All right, 7, test your pleasures. Test your pleasures. You know what the Lord says? He says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. There's the key to the disciplined mind. Another key is to test your pleasure. It's not just enough to discipline a certain way. It's test. What are you treasuring right now? So I want to, you got to get this. The expulsive power of a new affection is so important. It is the idea that if you are like a dog gnawing on a bone that you love, and you've been gnawing on this bone for 3 days, how do you get the dog to stop gnawing on the bone? The bone is sin. How do you do it? You go and you shake a juicy steak in front of him. And he'll go, I'm done. I'll get the steak. If you go instead and say, no, now let me tell you about this. That bone's not good for you. And you grab that bone, you're going to get, it's not going to go well. And that's the way it is for us. When we are tempted and we're struggling with sin, that's what it's like. Your mind's going to say, I remember in Camp Scholar, we talked about the discipline of the mind, so I'm going to grab that bone. Huh, you're going to get bit and hurt and bad things are going to happen. You can't just force yourself to stop sinning. What you've got to do is examine and test your pleasures. You've got to discipline yourself to look to Christ and find the beauty and the glory and the joy that you want Him more than that filth. You got to do it. I know everyone might, if you're thinking with me, you're going to say, how? Point one, pray. Fall on your face. And one of the other points, think hard. Think hard and exert yourself to discover and delight yourself in the Lord. Taste and see that the Lord is good. If you taste Him, truly, I had a very lucrative career, and I was actually not even at my prime yet. I was rising up in my organization in the laboratory, and it was phenomenal. Making all kinds of money, patents all over the place, there's stuff going on, royalties, and I think God just totally compelled and said, okay, you're done, bam, we're out of here. What happened was I had that was my bone, and that itself wasn't sin. All the pride associated with it was, but that was my bone, and what happened is God put in me an increasing view of how beautiful He is and how His value is so much greater. I dropped the bone. You got to do it. Number 8, avoid objects of temptation. Very simple. If you struggled with alcohol, don't visit bars, right? You struggle with pornography, don't move to Las Vegas. I mean, it just does, you know, use your mind to think. If you're struggling with this thing, don't go buy it. I mean, let me give you a very practical example. If you're driving home from work and you pass a certain corner store, and let's say in that store you have a pattern and a habit of dropping by and getting something, and you know, you get something to drink or whatever, and you have a struggle with drinking. Well, and you say, oh, I'm done, I'm stopping. And then you drive home, and boy, as soon as you start approaching that corner, those feelings come back. Avoid, take another route. Go drive somewhere else. Find a new route to go home. Change it up. Do whatever you can to help. That's the point. Avoid temptation. Baxter said, away with this fuel, fly from the infectious air if you would be safe. Number 9, prepare your mind for action. We talked about that. These are the 4 A's. Can you tell me? All sin. So all sin, no matter, don't leave any out. So all sin. Number 2, at first sight or at first glance, whatever you like better. But at the very first time you see it. 3, All the way. Don't leave an enemy living. Number four.
Always.
Always. Always. Always. All right. And number 10. Preach to yourself. Don't just let others preach to you. You preach to yourself. Preach to yourself. Preach to yourself. Preach to yourself. Constantly tell your mind. No. Remember this. Ooh. For me to live is Christ, to die is gain. For I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but it's Christ who lives in me. And the life that I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. So why would I do this? Preach to yourself. Number 11, flee from passions. And again, earlier, our brother gave us that word, and I was so grateful. I wanted to bring clarity. We are to flee from passions. 2 Timothy 2:22. So flee youthful passions and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those, watch this, who call upon the Lord with a pure heart. So point, the pure heart, the disciplined mind, will flee. So the point is, disciplining the mind doesn't mean you always fight. It means you gain wisdom to know what to do in every situation. You're disciplined so that you know, okay, if that happens, this is what I'm doing. And if it's sexual temptation, you flee. The Bible tells us that resist the devil and he'll flee from you. And then it says, but if sexual temptation comes, don't try to resist. You flee. It's so much more powerful even than Satan. Satan's on the outside, sexual temptation's on the inside. Flee. 12, choice over feelings. Don't give in to feelings. Don't give in to feelings. Feelings rule America. We are such a feeling ridiculous people. It's like feelings, feelings, feelings. I'm sick of it. You got to make choices, not feelings. We even use the word I feel to mean I think. No, don't say that. Say I think. This is I feel like. No. No. I'll find a chapter verse for that. Amen. Use the mind. Use the mind to say, no, this is true, this is right. You know, we used to use mind in the English language to mean obey. You better mind me, right? Or he doesn't mind very well. What does that mean? Well, it means doesn't obey. The mind is for obedience. Don't play games with feelings. All right, number 13, fellowship. Engage in conversation about the things of the Lord with other believers. It's critical. You must go back to your local churches. You must be committed to a local body of people who fear the Lord, who love the Lord, who are God-centered, and will indeed minister to you. You can't do this on your own. Another important part is fellowship. And number 14, listen to music that promotes Godward affections. Amen. You guys have been, I just love you guys. You're amazing. I love the music. You got all kinds of variety of music. That's amazing. That's beautiful. Use music for the glory of God. And believe me, it's in the scriptures. Proverbs 25:20. Whoever sings songs to a heavy heart is like one who takes off a garment on a cold day and like vinegar on soda. It's so good. When your heart's down, music can lift you up. When your heart is tempted and distracted, put on something that brings back the thoughts and helps to aid the mind to come back to center, to focus, and truly engage yourself. The scriptures say in Ephesians and in Colossians that with the word of God, we are to sing to one another, admonishing one another. That music should admonish us. Music should preach to us. But it preaches beyond the language of words. It preaches even through the human faculty of emotion. And it'll stir your heart. Let it. Use it. And my last and final, and I'm done, for the glory of God, is, make not thinking the end of thinking. Do not let thinking be your goal. I've talked a lot about thinking. It's not for the sake of thinking better. It's for the sake of making much of Christ. Let's pray.